So without looking at notes, we have our source table, three sources of variance, factor A, we've got therapist nested factor A, we've got subject nested between therapist and within treatments. With our degrees of freedom and the expected mean squares for each of those sources of variance. We're going to form an F ratio now to answer the main question, which is A1 different from A2? Is one method of psychotherapy outperforming the other method of psychotherapy? So we're going to get an expected value. We want an expected value of F, 2 degrees of freedom. We'll form a ratio of expected mean square A to something in order to test this, see if there's an effect for factor A. So what variance, what source of variance would we use, what mean square would we use to do this F test, to calculate that F ratio?
Mean tested.
Yeah, we would use this source of variance to test to see whether or not there's an effect for factor A. We use this source of variance, why? Why would we use this expected mean, or that mean square, to form that as a ratio?
Controls for the two at a time error. I mean, if you look at it, and if you divide the B sub A from the other one, it basically takes out the two other errors and errors terms and leaves the treatment error.
Right. We form an F ratio of the top mean square to the second mean square. We form an F ratio of mean square A to mean square B nested in A. Because the numerator and denominator are exactly the same, except for the one variance component that we're testing for significance. So the numerator and denominator have the same expected value, except for the one thing that you're testing for statistical significance, which in this case is theta squared A, the treatment variance. So if the treatment variance is zero, then that ratio should have an expected value of one. So you cross out theta squared A, and you have this F ratio of mean square A to mean square B nested in A, you have an expected value of F of one. If we were to form an F ratio with this as our error term, subjects, that would be a biased F test. Because we have three variance components in the numerator and one in the denominator. And so the variance due to therapists could, or the variance due to treatments could be zero. You still have a variance due to therapist in the numerator, which would make that F ratio large. So that would be a positively biased F test. So you know no treatment effect whatsoever, but you have therapist effects, then it could be statistically significant. And you're testing for the effect of treatments, and you're finding that it's a significant F, and it's not due to treatments, it's due to therapists. That's a serious problem. And that's what most people do. And we don't want to do that. So the appropriate denominator is therapists. That's the unit of analysis, is the therapist. And we have only 2 degrees of freedom. We don't have all 20 degrees of freedom associated with subjects, so it's not a very powerful test, but it's the appropriate test. It's the one that's unbiased.
It's a little confusing that one naturally tend towards just a subject, but it's a little confusing because you have to be already used to subjects, so you have to use them.
Yeah,
but it's a little misleading because you don't typically realize that.
Yeah, that's what we're trying to do is build awareness of these hierarchical data structures. You have to be aware of these things, and a lot of times it's not like people are doing things to sort of achieve and get significant F ratios when we shouldn't find significant results if we can publish. It's just that they're not aware of the fact that they've got this hierarchical data structure and they analyze the data improperly. They just say, I got 12 people that got treatment A1, I got 12 people that got treatment A2 at the t-test, or the one-way ANOVA. And what you're doing is dividing that mean square by this mean square. And you've got all these degrees of freedom. And that's a serious problem. There's a positively biased F ratios. I'm not that old.
So if you're trying to test the F ratio to find out the effect of factor B instead of factor A, in that case, right, just take the mean square from the B by A divided by the mean square of subjects
tested
to
mean. That's exactly right. Yeah, you can test to see if there are therapist effects.
I'm sorry?
You can test to see whether or not there are therapist effects.
Okay.
You can test to see whether or not the therapists are different, that administer the same treatment. By dividing this mean square by this one, that's an appropriate F test. It's got the same terms in the numerator and denominator, except for the one variance component that you're testing. So if there are no therapist effects, this variance is zero, and you've got an expected value of F, which is equal to one. Error variance divided by error variance, and that's appropriate.
So does this give me two different values for therapists in treatment A and then therapists in treatment B, or no? I'm trying to think. I mean, we have two therapists in each treatment.
Yeah.
What kind of value do I get? Do I get a different value for each group?
Well, no, it's pooled.
So it's a...
It's pooled.
Okay.
So it's just saying, are therapists different?
Okay.
Generally.
So comparing all four of them at the same time?
Yeah, or? But it doesn't do them, like, around the grand. It does it around the treatment.
Okay.
So within a treatment, or do you have therapists doing different things?
Okay.
That's what it says. Okay. It tells you whether or not, if they're doing the same therapy, are they still getting different results?
Okay.
It's kind of an ambiguous F. I mean, it gives you a test for therapist effects, but it's a test for random effects. And they're always ambiguous. You don't know what to do with it. You just know that you've got it. But they're not doing the same thing. What it tells you is you should train your therapist better. You're doing the same thing. That's what it tells you. So this is what, that was the appropriate thing, what we just did. That takes the nesting into account. It explicitly models the random factor therapist in the analysis. This is what people do. You'll see this often, very often in the literature. They don't recognize those nested factors, those random factors, the hierarchical structure of the data, and they just throw the 24 clients' data into the t-test program, and they get a t-ratio to see whether or not therapists or treatment one differs from treatment two. And they exclude the random factor. Fact that these six people got therapy from one therapist, and these six people got therapy from a different person.
One might even be fooled because maybe they always get treatment one in one building and treatment two in another building, and maybe it's an effect.
Yeah,
it
could have been. It could have been. So this is what their analysis of variance looks like if they do a one-way analysis of variance to see whether or not treatment A1 differs from treatment A2, they have their 1 degree of freedom for treatments that we did in the hierarchical line, and then they have variance for subjects nested in factor A, with A times N minus 1, where we've got 12 clients receiving treatment A1, and 12 receiving treatment A2. They have 11 degrees of freedom in each group, each two groups, a total of 22 degrees of freedom. And they divide the mean square factor A by the mean square of the subject's nested in A. If we ignore therapists as the factors that form a one-way analysis of variance, but we don't recognize it as a random factor, then we can calculate the expected value of F under those conditions. And this is a formulation that was introduced by Penny and Jed in 1986, Seth Bullock, and see if you can look that up if you want to read it. But this is a formula that tells you what the expected value of F would be if you were to ignore therapists, if you were to ignore that random factor in the design. What would the expected value of F be? And you can set the variance through the treatments to zero and figure out what the expected value would be under null conditions if you ignore the random factor. So that's what we're going to do. We'll just set the variance due to treatment to zero, so there is no treatment effect. There's no difference between UA1 and UA2. They're exactly equal to the grand mean. There's no treatment effect. And we establish values for the various parameters within the model. You got rho, that's what this is, the average correlation on observations. We're going to set that equal to 0.2. And you just have to sort of accept that for the moment. That's the initial class correlation coefficient. We're going to come back and talk about that at great length later. But let's just say that there's some linkage among the scores within groups. And that linkage is a value between 0 and 1. And that in that particular case, it's actually negative linkage too. We'll show an example of that. But it's a positive linkage, so people that get therapy from therapist one are all sort of low, and people that get therapy from therapist two are all kind of high. So it's a positive relationship in terms of the error components. That's a moderate correlation. Not a very strong correlation, but that's probably at the low end of what you'd expect from a study with a bunch of psychotherapists and mainstream psychotherapy with clients, about 0.2, it could go up to about 0.4, 0.5, something like that. You see those in the literature. M is the number of members in a therapy group, in this case it's 6. 6 clients for each therapist. And N is the number of subjects in each treatment condition. So we got a total of 12 subjects received treatment A1, 12 received treatment A2. And we assume no effective treatment, completely null result, there's no effective treatment. We plug these numbers in to the formula that Kenny and Jeb give us, and we calculate that the expected mean square for factor A, the numerator of your F ratio, has an expected mean square of 2 sigma square sub e, or 2 times error variance. That's the numerator of the F. It's just a bunch of arithmetic to get there. The expected mean square for subjects nested in A, this is the other formula they provide, is the expected mean square for the denominator. We plug in the various values, we get 0.91 times error variance. So we form a ratio of the expected mean square A to the expected mean square subjects nested in A. We get 2 times error variance in the numerator and 0.91 times error variance in the denominator, which gives an expected F ratio of 2.2. That's under null conditions. There is no treatment effect. And you just analyze the data without taking into account the fact that these clients receive therapists and therapists, the nested in therapists, you form an F ratio that has an expected value of 2.2. That's this situation. Because we violated the independence assumption, the scores are linked by a value of 0.2, which is a pretty conservative measure of linkage for this kind of study. The sampling distribution of F under null conditions is flatter than the central F, than what it should be. And as a consequence, you've got the wrong critical value. It should be out here, but you're putting it back here, and you've got a large, high probability of a type 1 error. The expected value of F under null conditions is 2.2. What should it be under null conditions? It should be 1, and it's 2.2. It's more than twice what it should be. So you've got a high risk of type 1. That's serious, serious bias in this statistical test. And if you increase that row to 0.4, it goes up dramatically. The expected value of F goes up, I don't know what it goes up to, but it goes up dramatically. So even with a moderate level of violation of the independence assumption, we've got a very significant effect on the F ratio. Going back to our experimenter that didn't recognize the fact that they had a nested design, a hierarchical design, they analyzed it inappropriately with 1 and 22 degrees of freedom. Even if there is no treatment effect, we know it's true, if there's sufficient linkage among the clients within therapists, like rho is greater than zero, the F for A may be statistically significant to be positively biased.
Can you remind me what the rho is? Is it all of the clients? You're saying it's the linkage between clients within the therapist. So does that mean you have four different correlations? I missed that part, I'm sorry. What, how do you get rho?
Well, we haven't talked about how you get rho yet. Rho is what's called an intra-class correlation coefficient. We will spend a lot of time talking about how you calculate that. But if you go back to that example I had earlier with the couples, where we had the error components were the husbands and wives, and the H1 and W1 were positive values, H2 and W2 were negative values. If you just correlate those paired observations, that correlation is what that is indicating, is that measure of linkage between the error components. It's the extent to which you can distinguish among the clients based on knowledge of which therapist they have. So if you have a situation that looks like this, you can really distinguish well among these groups. These therapists are really quite different. And you can distinguish well between the groups based on knowledge of the septic score. So there's lots of variability among therapists. And to the extent that you have lots of variability among therapists, you're going to have a large intra-class correlation coefficient. So, you can think of that, if you were randomly to take two scores from this distribution, just randomly take two scores out of that distribution, two scores out of that distribution, and then correlate those. It's kind of hard to do with just four or two paired observations, because correlation would be perfect. But let's say you've got four therapists administering the same treatment. So these are all administering the same treatment. So we randomly take two scores from therapist one, two scores from therapist two, two scores from therapist three, two scores from therapist four. So we've got four paired observations. We correlate those, that's rho. And if you have two low scores, you can have a couple scores here that are coming from either one of those distributions, but you have two low scores from this therapist, two moderately low scores from this therapist, two moderately high scores from this therapist, and two very high scores from this therapist. And so,
do you average those two that you're grabbing from each and then correlate all the values?
No,
you just average
two scores. Just take two scores, X and Y for therapist one, X and Y for therapist two, X and Y for therapist three, X and Y for therapist four. You have four paired observations, you do a correlation coefficient. And those, that correlation would be very large. And just randomly sampling from those distributions. And if that's true, you're violating the inequality. The grouping is what produces the correlation. In fact, the groups are different from each other. It's what produces that correlation. If the groups are all stacked on top of each other, there's no difference among variables. If you just randomly, it's just one distribution, just randomly taking two scores and saying that's therapist one, two scores say that's therapist two, there's no correlation. It's the fact that you're different is what produces the correlation. Yeah.
So why would we take just two scores instead of like three or four? What can we do for that? Or?
Well, it's conceptually is what you're doing. When you can do it over and over and over and over again, like an infinite number of times, and average all those correlations, that would be row. Uh-huh. That would be the population correlation. But conceptually, you could just do it once and get an estimate of row.
And what if you take all of them, like you have n is equal to 6 in each group, mm-hmm. if you take all of them at all times, I mean 6, and then compare all of them together, would that be also a row or not?
Well, you have 6 people here,
right?
And you take 2 of those scores at random, 2 out of 6.
No, I'm saying if you don't take 2 out of 6, and we take 6 out of 6 every time, and then take correlation of that, what would that be?
Well,
of all the groups comparing 6 from, would that be something different?
You have to have paired observations to do a correlation coefficient, right? So you can't take 6. They have to be 2 pairs, you know, x and y.
Okay.
So you take a pair from this distribution,
okay.
Just random, any okay. 2, just take 2. And then you take 2 from this one. And that's your second pair.
Mm-hmm.
And then the third pair is from the third group, and the fourth pair is from the fourth group. And then you just correlate those. And you could do that over and over again. So you take a different 2 subjects from here, or maybe one of the same and a different one. You do it over and over and over again, lots and lots of times, and you get a bunch of correlation coefficients. And the mean of those correlations interclass correlation. And it's going to be large to the extent that these groups are different from each other. If they're all stacked on top of each other, it's going to be a correlation of 0. So we have an expected value of f. It's too large because you've got too many variance components in the numerator and not enough in the denominator, and they're multiplications. So if there's large variability among therapists, you're going to get a large F ratio, and it has nothing to do with the treatment effect. It looks like it's an effect of treatment, but it's not. It's due to therapist effects. And in addition, you're going to be testing your F ratio with 22 degrees of freedom in the denominator. Because you've got 24 clients, you figure you've got 22 degrees of freedom. Well, you don't have 22 degrees of freedom, you have 2 degrees of freedom. Because the unit of analysis is the therapist. And you've only got 1 degree of freedom in treatment A1 and 1 degree of freedom in treatment A2. You've only got 2 degrees of freedom. So not only is your F ratio too large, but you're going to be looking at the wrong critical value in the table because you calculated the wrong number of degrees of freedom. So it's like adding insult to injury. These are two things that are going to give you too many type 1 errors. Two reasons why it's the wrong thing to do. If you have negative language among your scores, a negative correlation among scores, then it produces a negative bias type test. You can actually set rho equal to a negative value. In this case, it says a negative 0.1, and work out the expected value of f, and the f is less than half of what it should be. It should be 1 under null conditions, and it's 0.4, 7-8 normal conditions, and that's a situation where you have negative linkage, a negative correlation between scores between groups. So how is that going to happen, that you get a negative correlation between groups? The only way, I think, the only thing I come up with is a way that you could get a negative linkage is if your dependent variable is something like talk time, the amount of time that people talk. So you have a husband and a wife sitting in counseling, and you're measuring the amount of time each one talks. Well, if the wife is talking a lot, then the husband's not saying much, because there's only, you know, so much time, and if the, the wife has a high score, the husband's going to have to have a low score. And vice versa, if the husband's doing all the talking, the wife's just sitting there, then one's going to be high and one's going to be low. So if you have a dependent variable like that, you could have a negative correlation, where a high score with one individual goes with a low score is paired with a low score for the other individual.
Would you have a negative linkage if you had, like in our town, we had a high school and then we had an alternate high school, and the boys and girls who misbehaved or whatever, and that one would be left in high school, would that be considered a negative linkage because they're so different from each other? One was actually extracted from the other because of.
Well, it would depend on the dependent variable, what it is you're measuring, but in that example, I would think it's probably still a positive one, because you'd end up having problem students in one school and good students and less fewer problem students in the other school, and so the one group would be higher on average than the other group. And so then that would be a positive. Yeah, positive linkage is more common. That's why it's more problematic, because you end up getting positively biased F-tests. You're making too many type 1 errors. If you have negative linkage, you make too few type 1 errors. Your type 1 error rate would be too low. You'd say it's 0.05 instead of 0.01. Well, that's not a bad thing, that, you know, you're making fewer type 1 errors. So that's not a problem. You don't have enough power, but at least you're not misleading people that are reading the research results and saying there's a treatment effect in fact you don't. So, like I mentioned earlier, statisticians tend to make mountains out of molehills. You know, like they make the big deal out of 1 or 2% type 1 error problems and inflation of type 1 error rates. Or you can say, well, you know, you worry about these hierarchical designs, and okay, I recognize that there's a hierarchical design and you're making too many type 1 errors, but how often do we have a hierarchical design in real life? Well, Fritz Christoph Mintz, back in 1991 in the Journal of Consulting and Clinical Psychology, which is like a top tier journal in that field, did a study where they went through an entire year of articles in that journal. This is like the top tier journal in the field. And they found that the therapist was treated as a random factor that was properly ruled out. They used like a hierarchical analysis of variance or hierarchical linear model to analyze the data. And only 3.5% of the studies that they looked at. These are the people that did it the right way. 3.5% of the studies in the top tier journal in the field did the right thing. And 96.5% of them did the wrong thing. So 96.5% had invalid statistical tests. And it makes you, when you think about that, when these people are making drawing conclusions about treatments and effectiveness of this or that, when your statistical tests are completely invalid. Like, it's like you're flipping coins to see whether or not the thing works or not. And it's no wonder that people aren't making progress in their field. When you're doing statistical tests that are invalid, you're coming up with wrong conclusions. Or some of them, you could be right. I mean, you got right half the time, wrong half the time. but you're not building any knowledge. You're not creating new knowledge. You're not building anything because you don't know what's right, what works, and what doesn't work in a situation like that. So as a consequence of this article, that journal will not accept a publication, will not accept a manuscript now that does not explicitly rule it out, rule out therapist effects or analyze and look for therapist effects and take them into account. So you can't publish in that journal anymore unless you do that. So that's good. It was a really good outcome. We followed that up with a study a few years later where we looked at the small group psychotherapy literature. And we looked at the study of 76 studies over a period of, what was it? In 1980 to 1992. And this is small group psychotherapy. Well, in small group psychotherapy, they're sort of capitalizing on the fact we've got a small group of people that are working together, and you'd expect those people to be linked. I mean, that's the whole idea, is that you want them to be linked. I mean, that's how the therapy works, if you have these people working together in small groups. So you think of anybody who is going to be sensitive to the effects of groups, it would be the small group psychotherapy researchers. Well, we found that only 8.5% of those investigators did a proper statistical analysis of their data. I don't know what is happening to that area of research, but again, it's like, how do they expect to make any kind of progress if they're not sort of taking these serious issues into account? So these are not, this is not a mountain out of a molehill. If anything, we need to stand up and say, you're doing the wrong thing, you're doing the wrong thing, and let's just not do that anymore. Be aware of it and avoid these very serious problems with type 1 error rates. At this point, I was hoping to do a Monte Carlo simulation for the software that Takashi would be using later, but for some reason, when I tried it last night, it didn't run. So I have some debugging to do. I'll try to come back and do that later. But one possible solution to the problem of having linked observations is to just aggregate your score up. So we can solve the problem. Statistically, we can solve the problem by just aggregating up. And that's what that third researcher did. The third researcher, remember, given the data set, they calculated one average class size in school one and an average achievement in school one, then went to school two, and they did that for school two, and they did that for school three, and they came up with four paired observations and looked at the relationship between class size achievement in those four schools. That's aggregating up to the level of schools. So we don't analyze the data at the level of classrooms, we analyze it at the level of schools. Well, statistically, that's a very sound approach. It gives you valid statistical tests. You're not violating independence assumptions, you're aggregating up. The problem becomes, what is the construct that you're measuring? What are you measuring? You're not really answering the question that you think you're answering. But statistically, it's not a problem. You don't get a statistically biased result. So in this example, what we could do to solve this problem is just take the six clients that their mental health scores, for therapist one, and aggregate them, get the average score for therapist one. We get the average score for therapist two, just average all these scores. And you get four scores. And you do your t-test with four scores, your four therapist meetings. And that's exactly what the hierarchical analogies do. You had 1 and 2 degrees of freedom for the hierarchical analysis of variance. But it was analyzing the means for these therapists. So you have two observations in treatment A1, you have two observations in treatment A2, you got 1 degree of freedom here, you got another degree of freedom there, you got 1 and 2 degrees of freedom. Those are the irritative and the grievous. The therapist means. And that's the test of the effective factor gating. That's the appropriate test. The problem is, you don't have any power. You don't get 2 degrees of freedom for your error term. It's very little power, statistical test. Aggregation is very common. We do it all the time. We may not even think about it. If you hand somebody a questionnaire, like an intelligence test or a spelling test, and they fill it out, you count up the number correct, and use that score for the subject. That's aggregating. That's aggregation. You're aggregating the scores in that questionnaire up to a total score for that individual. And then you use that as your score on the variable. It's very common. You do it all the time. And there's nothing wrong with that. We just don't think of the individual scores in questionnaires as being nested within a person, but that's essentially what it is. We could use the therapist means as our dependent variable, and we'd end up with a one-way ANOVA, where we're treating the scores, the means for therapists as a dependent variable. We have one numerator to grade freedom, two denominators to use the either ANOVA, and it would be perfectly valid.
John, earlier you had said that when you aggregate, you know, the construct may change.
Yes.
In this example, it's not.
It's not.
It's just that we're losing degrees of freedom.
You have very, very few degrees of freedom. That's the problem with aggregation, is that 2-3 degrees of freedom is a treatment. You have very low power. It's just the nature of this hierarchy of data structure, where your unit of analysis is at some intermediate level, where you don't have a whole lot of therapists in your study, and as a consequence, you don't have enough degrees of freedom. That's why we recommend, if you're going to do this, you can, it's better to have lots of therapists that see just a couple of clients each than it would be to have a few therapists that see lots of clients, because the degrees of freedom are really based on the therapist and they're not based on the clients. The clients do help have lots of clients, but it's better to have lots of therapists and a few clients than vice versa. An alternative that's been around in the literature since the 40s, as far as I can tell, is a two-stage hypothesis testing approach. In this case, we set up the analysis to do the hierarchical analysis of variance, where we do it the standard way. We identify the three sources of variance, we generate our mean squares, and we test our F ratio to see if there's an effect for treatment. So we test F for factor A using mean square A and mean square B nested in A. So this has very low power, very few degrees of freedom, 1 and 2 degrees of freedom. It's entirely appropriate. We have the appropriate F ratio with the same terms in the numerator and denominator, except for the one variance for testing the variance for treatment. And so that's the appropriate after test. We test this and see if it's statistically significant. That's the first stage, is to do that F ratio. If it's significant, you're done. It's great. You got a treatment effect, you have very low power, you were able to reject the null hypothesis, you conclude that the F ratio is significant, that there was a significant difference between A1 and A2. But chances are, it's not going to be significant because you only have 2 degrees of freedom. So you follow that up. If you have a non-significant F test, if you do it the right way, and it's not significant, let's try another way. If the F is not significant, at stage 2, you test to see whether or not there are therapist effects. So we form an F ratio to see if the therapists within treatments are different from each other. So we form an F ratio for B nested in A, which is mean square B nested in A divided by mean square subjects nested in A. You can see that you got the appropriate F ratio if you divide the expected mean square for B nested in A by the expected mean square for subjects nested in A. They have error variance in the numerator and denominator. They only differ by the therapist variance. And so if the therapist variance is zero, you have an expected value of 1, which is appropriate. So we test this to see if there are therapist effects. If that's not significant, and we choose a large alpha to do the statistical test, because in this case, a high risk of type 1 error is actually a conservative thing to do. So we choose a large alpha, like 20%, and different authors will say different things. Some say 20, some say 30, not 30. But we choose a large alpha, and if the F ratio is, if the F ratio for therapists is significant with this large alpha, then you're done. You can't do anything more. You failed to reject the null hypothesis with respect to the treatment. So you've got a non-significant F for factor A, and you've got a non-significant, but you've got a significant effect for therapists, you're done. You can talk about therapist effects, why the therapist is different, but you can't talk about the effect of treatment. So you've got a null result. But if the F ratio for therapist is not significant, even though you were really looking for it with this large alpha. So if there's any evidence whatsoever of therapist effect, you're going to detect it. But if there is no therapist effect, then you're concluding that there is no variance to the therapist. So that variance component drops out of the expected mean squares. So there's no therapist variance in the expected mean square for A, and there's no therapist variance in the expected mean square for therapists. All you have is error variance for the mean square for factor B for therapists. It's just error variance. There's no therapist variance. There is no variance for therapists. That's what you concluded, that the variance is zero. So it drops out. So now what you have are two estimates of error variance. You have one for therapist, and you have another one for subjects nested within therapists. You have two ways of measuring the same variance component. And you can pool those and use them as a denominator. That's not supposed to be there. That line is supposed to be up here. Maybe it's, I don't know what it looks like on your account, but you form a ratio, or you form a mean square residual, which is pooling the variance, the sum of squares for therapists and the sum of squares for clients, and use a freedom for therapists and use a freedom for clients, and you form that mean square. You get an average squared deviation with that pooled set of sums of squares and pooled degrees of freedom to get you an average or pooled measure of error variance. It's a better measure of error variance than either one of the other ones will be, because you have two things estimated the same variance component, so you pool them. You pool them by pooling your sums of squares and degrees of freedom. So now you have a pooled measure of error variance that you can use for testing the effect of factor A. So again, sorry about these lines, they're supposed to be up here. You perform an F ratio to test factor A with expected mean square A divided by expected mean square residual, which is formed this way. That's the expected value of F under null conditions. This is the expected value of F, and if there is no treatment effect, then you have the appropriate F ratio with an expected value of 1. Okay, you can do this pooling. This is the way it's described in the textbooks. Or you can just reanalyze the data as a one-way analysis of variance for getting therapists, because there are no therapists in fact you don't have to worry about. So you just run it as a one-way ANOVA, like everybody else does, and it's still a valid F because you already know you ruled out the therapist effects.
Is there an advantage to combining the two error in terms of the pulling the error in terms
of the there's an advantage in the 40s and the 50s when this was described, because you were using a hand calculator. And you went through the process of calculating these things, and now all you can do is form this simple addition and revision, and you got your error term, and it's very easy. But nowadays, with SPSS or SAS, you just click a button, and now you run it a different way. That's a lot easier than doing this. Just run it over as one way and over. See? So that's a two-stage hypothesis testing approach. And summarize, this is just a summary of what we did. If the F for B nested in A is not significant, you fool the sums of squares, you fool the degrees of freedom, and you compute a pooled or average measure of error variance, call it mean square residual. Then we can compute a new F ratio for factor A, you get this new denominator. We use the same numerator that we used in the first stage, but we use a new denominator. We got a lot of degrees of freedom now. We got all these degrees of freedom. So clients, the unit of analysis, not therapists. So we've got lots of degrees of freedom, and we've got a much more powerful test for treatment effects. Okay? Any questions about that? So this is just a worked out example. First stage, we conduct our F test. We divide 50 by 14, the mean square for factor A by the mean square for the therapist nested in A. 50 by 14, we get an F ratio of 3.3. The critical value of F with 1, 2 degrees of freedom is 18.5. So our 3.3 doesn't cut it. It's not significant. Doesn't exceed the critical values. So we proceed to stage two. We calculate an F ratio for therapist nested in A. We divide 14 by 10 and get an F ratio of 1.4, which is not significant. The P value is greater than 0.25. So we conclude that there is no therapist variance. So we can pool our sums of squares, 50 and 28 for a therapist and 200 for subjects nested in A, and 40 degrees of freedom, 20 degrees of freedom. We find this ratio, calculate the pooled measure of error variance, which is 10.36. We go back to this test now for factor A, where we divide 50 by this new error term, 10.36, which equals, of course, 1.82, which is significant with 22 degrees of freedom. So we conclude that there was a treatment effect. We couldn't make the first F ratio of the error of the second.
Going back to the previous slide, where we have the formula for FA, not this one, yes, this one here. Shouldn't the degrees of freedom here should be A minus 1, then A, it should be A times B n minus 1, right? When we add up, when we pull it up, when we pull up the degrees of freedom? Because...
What does that work out to be? B n minus 1, it's 11 degrees of freedom. This is 4.
Because this is a sum. This is the degrees of freedom for
4 and 5. It's 20.
Yeah. So this is.
Yeah.
It
so the other set of different degrees of freedom.
So it should be, I think, a times b n minus 1.
A times b.
B n minus 1 in the brackets. B times n minus 1 in the brackets.
A to b n.
No, a outside the brackets and then inside the brackets.
B n
minus 1.
Well,
for the pool. Could I just add, if you just add it up?
Yeah, there's a difference of 2 degrees of freedom there. If you did this, this is from the hierarchical analysis. This is 2 times 2 times 5. So that's 20 degrees of freedom. If you do this. If you do the alternative approach, which is what I suggested, which is you just rerun the analysis as a one-way ANOVA without therapists, then you end up with 22 degrees of freedom instead of 20. So you get a couple more degrees of freedom if you go that way. So I'm not sure, maybe I'm not correct, that's the appropriate thing to do. Because this is what you find in the textbooks.
But shouldn't it, basically from this, does that mean that A minus 1 is the degrees of freedom for the numerator? And the other one is the degrees of freedom for the denominator, right? Is that what it means? Can you write things each other?
Well, if there is no therapist, if you just drop out therapists, then it's A times N minus 1, where N is the number of clients who receive treatment A1, and the clients who receive treatment A2. So N is 12, not 6. So it's 12 minus 1 times 2, which is 22 degrees of freedom. And we do this, and we say that we have therapists, so it's 2 times 2 with 6 minus 1 degrees of freedom for each therapist, then it's 20. It's 2 times 2 times 5. 20 degrees of freedom. Either 20 or 20. There are problems associated, there are always problems, right? Never very clear. Even in math, at least in applied math, it's never very clear. Maybe in math it's clear, but it's not in applied math. The problems with two-stage hypothesis testing are, one, that the possibility of fooling error term depends on finding a non-significant after factor for therapists. You gotta have a non-significant effort factor B for therapists in order to fool. If it's significant, you can't fool. And you end up with 2 degrees of freedom. And you don't know that until after you've collected your data, whether or not that effort is going to be statistically significant. So you're sort of gambling on the lack of difference between your therapists that administer the same treatment. And if there is no difference between the therapist who administers the same treatment, then you can fool. And you've got lots of degrees of freedom, you've got pretty good power. But if there are significant differences among the therapists, then you can't fool. And you're stuck with that test where a therapist is a unit of analysis and you don't have very many degrees of freedom. So one thing you can do is train your therapist really well. So you're doing exactly the same thing. So there's no significant difference between therapists. And then if you do that, then you've got a high probability of being able to fool. And you have lots of power to test for your effects of treatment. But you don't know until you've collected the data whether or not you can do that. And another problem is one that's not in the books. And it actually applies to what we do in HLM, so I'm thinking that this might be a master's project for somebody who, if somebody in the MSTAT program is for a master's project, this could be a pretty interesting one. The problem is, and this was discovered originally by Akolikova, who was one of my MSTAT students in mathematics. This was back when the Berlin Wall came down. And she was a PhD math student, and when the Berlin Wall came down, all of the Soviet mathematicians migrated to the West. They came over here because they had great jobs, and the universities made out like bandits because they were getting these guys for, they didn't cost very much, and they're brilliant mathematicians. And so you have all these mathematicians flooding the U.S. universities. And so the students now that are working in the PhDs in mathematics weren't getting jobs. They couldn't get into academia because all the positions were being taken by the former Soviet scientists. are mathematicians. So we got these really great math students going into statistics, because you always get a job in statistics. So it was great. We had really great students. Well, Maggie was one of those people. So she was really a brilliant mathematician. And she worked on this problem. And she found that if you follow that two-stage hypothesis testing approach, you do increase the risk of type 1 error. It's like you got two shots at testing for the effects of treatment. You do your F ratio the right way, and if it's not significant, you get another shot at it by pooling, testing for therapist effects and pooling. And so because you get two shots at testing the same hypothesis, you do inflate the risk of type 1 error. It's not like a huge effect. It's only a couple percentage points, but it is an inflation of type 1 error to do that. And subsequently, this was published in the American Statistician. There was a study that somebody else did that showed basically the same thing. But you don't see the textbooks sort of saying, don't do this two-stage hypothesis testing because of the inflation of type 1 error. So it hasn't made it into the textbooks yet, but it's in the literature. So there is an issue there. And the reason I say this is kind of an issue is because you'll see we're doing the same thing we get into HLM. When we start doing these modeling with hierarchical linear with HLM-6, and this is what people do, they do preliminary tests to see if they have effects of random factors, if they have a significant effect for therapists. You do these preliminary tests for random effects. And if they're not significant, and they're using alpha 0.05, they're not using 0.2, which is conservative in that case. They're using a small alpha. If they're not significant, they fix them. They say, there are no random effects in my model. And then they get all these degrees of freedom for testing the treatment effects. And this is what everybody's doing these days. So I see that as a bit of a problem, especially because they're using alpha 0.05. They should probably be using alpha 0.2. And even then, there's going to be a problem. So what I'm thinking is this would be a great master's project. If somebody wants to do something for an MSTAT project, you could do a Monte Carlo simulation. We've got a lot of software for doing that kind of thing. And you could demonstrate that if you follow the logic that everybody's doing now with hierarchical linear modeling, multi-level modeling, where they're fixing these random effects and gathering all these degrees of freedom to test for treatment effects, they've got inflated type 1 error rates. But it's still acceptable. That's the way people do research these days. So people are still doing that. And just be aware that you're going to be inflating your type 1 error rates if they do that. The other problem with this two-stage approach is that the power to detect the variance among levels of factor B within levels of factor A is often inadequate. So we were testing the therapist effects with two therapists in treatment A1 and two therapists in treatment A2. We had how many B nested in A, so it would be two times. How many degrees of freedom do you have to B nested in A? It would be B, or A times B minus 1. So it's 2 times 1. So we have 2 degrees of freedom. We have 2 degrees of freedom for therapists in the numerator. We got a bunch in the denominator, but that's not a lot of degrees of freedom for testing for therapist effects. So you don't have a lot of power for testing for therapist effects. And if you have a lot of power, then you're likely to retain the null hypothesis in that case. And if you retain the null hypothesis, then you pool and you get to test your test for factor A with the pool means. So an underpowered study with respect to therapists is going to lead to pooling the error terms for your F test for factor A, which means you get a second shot at testing for factor A, which inflates your type 1 errors. So So that's kind of the problem. Okay. But maybe one of these guys is making a mountain out of a molehill at this point too. So take it for what it's worth. Okay, any questions about any of that we talked about? I'm going to talk about something else now. Another way in which people violate the independence assumption. So one way is to have these grouped factors, these people nested within groups and not take the grouping into account. You got students nested in classrooms and you don't take that into account. You got students nested in classrooms and schools and you don't have that, you don't take that. Another place where people have made this mistake of violating the independence assumption is in single subject designs. And you don't see this very often anymore, but in the old days, in a single subject design, people would, this is, you have one child, and it's usually a child with special problems, and you record some behavior that you're trying to get rid of in this child. Could be headbanging incidents or something. The child bangs his head against the wall and you want to prevent, close head injury or something. So you want to implement some sort of treatment to keep this child from banging his or her head. Although this wouldn't be a very good example of that because headbanging growing up with the treatment, so that's not a good example. But what they do is they record the behavior over a period of days. This is a baseline period. This is before they implement any kind of treatment. So you've got, 9 days or 10 days where you're recording this behavior just occurring naturally. And then you implement some treatment. So this is the A phase or the baseline phase, and then you have a treatment phase or the B phase, where you implement some sort of treatment that's designed to increase the behavior. So this might be altruistic behaviors or something for a child. So we want to increase the number of altruistic behaviors. So we implement some sort of treatment. Whenever they do it, you give them an M&M. And so their altruistic behaviors increase. And so you measure their altruistic behavior for a period of time after the treatment's been happening. And then they take the data, these 30 observations, and you do a t-test where you get the scores for the first 10 days, the baseline phase, you get a mean and a variance for those. If you move it here to the acute phase, you get a mean and a variance for those scores. You do a t-test to see if the A phase is different from the B phase. Is there a significant effect of treatment for this child? Well, there's a problem with that, and the problem is that these obstacles, this is the approach that they take it. We calculate the mean for the baseline phase and subtract the mean for the treatment phase, get percent of squares and the baseline phase and sum of squares and the treatment phase, you divide by the degrees of freedom, and you form your t-test with n1 plus n2 minus 2 degrees of freedom, so you have 28 degrees of freedom. This is standard even sample t-test. If the scores on the successive days are independent of each other, then the theoretical sample distribution of T will center on zero, and for some number of degrees of freedom has a certain shape. And you can set up critical values on this distribution, and you get a T that exceeds this critical value or reject. You get a T that exceeds that critical value from the negative direction to the objective hypothesis. Any T ratio between the cutoffs, you retain the null hypothesis. It's a standard median sample t-test. But that's assuming that the scores for this child and successive days are independent of each other. If the scores are not independent, if they're correlated with each other, then this distribution of t is flatter than it should be. It still centers on zero, but it's flatter than it should be. So when you set these critical values on this distribution, which is the correct distribution, if the scores are correlated, then your type 1 error rates go way up. It's not 5% anymore, it's like 20%, something like that. It's because you violated the independence assumption. And this was very common in single subject research years ago. You don't see people doing that much anymore. There are various kinds of dependency that can occur in time series data. You're recording the same behavior over multiple days from the same individual. The types of serial dependency that occur can be modeled with something called ARENA, which was introduced by Box and Jenkins, probably in the 40s, something. ARIMA stands for Autoregressive Integrated Moving Average, A-R-I-M-A, Autoregressive Integrated Moving Average. And this is just, you know, sort of, it's just, I don't want to go into a lot of detail. You need to take a class in time series. Some of you probably have, so it's just sort of a refresher of those individuals. But there are various kinds of dependency that can occur. If there's no autocorrelation, then the score at time t for subject, the receptor y at time t, is equal to the base of t, which is a called random shock. I don't know what they call random shocks, but it's just a random shock. And there's no, those shocks are not correlated with each other. So the score obtained on Monday is not related in any way to the score obtained on Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday. There's no relationship, no linkage. A way to predict what happens on Tuesday from what happens on Monday. So they're all independent. And that's the model. If there's no other correlation, y is just equal to that independent observation. Autoregressive process is one where the score at time t depends on the score at time t minus 1. So the score on Tuesday, y at time Tuesday, is dependent on the score on Monday, time t minus 1, previous observation, plus a random shock. And it's phi is just some multiplier. It's a coefficient. So it's some number between 0 and 1. There's 0 and 0.99999999. And it's to the extent that it depends on the previous observation, that phi coefficient is going to be close to 1. So the score on Tuesday is really the score on Monday plus a random shock. And if that's the case, it's called an autoregressive process. And it's a type of dependency that can occur in time series. This is an integrated process. This is where the value for phi is 1. It actually is 1. And so the score for a subject on Tuesday is equal to the score on Monday plus a random shock. And that's an integrated process. That's where phi is equal to 1. It's a special case. And then moving average is where the score at time t is equal to a random shock at time t plus, you can think of this as a plus, a piece of the previous random shock, where theta is some portion of the previous random shock. And it's a different kind of serial dependency that can occur in time series. It's a different way of modeling. These autoregressive moving average models actually converge with lots of parameters that become the same thing, but it's easier to model them if you think of them as separate. So there's just different kinds of autocorrelation that can occur in time series, and any one of them can affect your type 1 error rate. So this is the Monte Carlo simulation that I did one afternoon, I didn't even write it to, where I manipulated the value for phi and integrated in a autoregressive process where I manipulated the value for phi from 0 up to 1, and so 0.8. And I had 40 observations, I don't remember how many baseline phase and treatment phase, probably 20. But I just did a t-test to compare the baseline to the treatment phase with 40 observations with varying levels of autocorrelation in the time series. And you can see that the type 1 error rates with no treatment effect, this is just random numbers, the type 1 error rates greatly increases with the value of 5 with the degree of linkage. So we get up to about 60 to 50% type 1 errors with a very strong autocorrelation in the time series. So these are not trivial type 1 errors. And again, these kinds of numbers are not unusual within a single subject. We see this idea that in the physiological data with like heart rates and respiration and things like that, our autocorrelation, our phi coefficients are quite large. You're usually up in that range. So if you don't take that into account, you have a serious problem taking the averages. With moving average processor, this is theta, and this manipulated theta. The effect on type 1 error rate is not nearly as significant as it was for a noisy aggressive process. But it's still an inflated risk of type 1 error, even if you have a moving average process. So it's still a problem. How often does serial dependency occur in actual simple subject designs? Again, are we making a mountain out of a molehill? Well, Jones, Watt, and Weinrod in 1977 reported that 83% of studies in the Journal of Applied Behavior Analysis, which is sort of the main journal in simple subject design, this used to be, I don't know whether it is anymore, still Jones is different. So Java had significant lag on autocorrelation in 45% of the studies. That phi coefficient is 0.7, greater than 0.7. So it's way out there where those type 1 error rates would be very large if you were doing an example of this. It's not trivial. And then one problem with that study was that they didn't remove the treatment effect from that, they did that meta-analysis, they didn't remove the treatment effect. Well, there's a treatment effect that's going to increase the estimate of that autocorrelation. So you've got to look within a treatment to look for that fiber regressive parameter. You can't look just across a small time series. There's a treatment effect that's going to look like autocorrelation. So the problem with that study. So one of my MSTAT students redid this study in 1992, did it the right way, where she looked within phases at the autoregressive parameter, and still it was the average was 0.64, so it's still substantial. It wasn't as large as what Jones reported, but it's still substantial. That was another MSTAT project. It's sort of evaluating the variations on the theme here, with all the MSTAT students are working on problems with serial dependency or dependency and type 1 errors. So any questions about that? The point here is I want you to be aware that these are serious problems. They occur, they're ubiquitous in the literature. You can read an article, and if you're sensitive to these nesting problems, you can see it all over the place. And so you want to be careful when you interpret the results of research that you're aware of this, and if you're aware of it, and you see it, and the investigator didn't explicitly take it into account, these violations of independence have significant effect on type 1 error rates. And so you can't trust the results. You just don't know what happened in that study. It's like the statistical test is not informative. So we want to be able to do it the right way, and that's what we're doing. Any questions about that? We're going to take 5 minutes. Take 5 if we're behind, and then we'll come back and start going through the basic questions.
I don't have any clothes.
You don't have any?
Same levels of the independent variable in both studies. They represented the studies, so the effects are going to be constant. And we have to estimate those effects. And we might not know what they are exactly, but we can estimate them. Examples of fixed factors, male-female, Catholic versus Protestant, control versus experimental, placebo versus amphetamine versus insulin. So these are examples of fixed factors, fixed meaning and variables. In each of the first three cases, which is two levels, male, female, Catholic, Protestant, we wouldn't generalize to Muslims if we had a study of Catholic and Protestant. With control and experimental, we wouldn't generalize beyond those two conditions. In this case, we have three levels of variable, and we wouldn't generalize beyond those three conditions. Traditionally, fixed effects are defined as we have here. Alpha sub J is mu sub J minus the grand mean. We've seen this before. So it's a difference of the grand mean, or the peak mean and the grand mean. In HLM, a fixed effect in HLM is denoted with a gamma. It's a different symbol than alpha. These gammas represent fixed effects. So when you see gamma, it's going to be a fixed effect. Under greenouts, in the notes, all of that from here on out, we're going to use gammas to represent fixed effects. And in this case, we might define gamma as the difference between two treatment means, U2 and U1. That's a gamma, that's a fixed effect. It's a constant difference between those two populations. So data from a control experimental study with control experimental groups. We did a t-test to see if the fixed effect, the difference between U1 and U2 is different from zero. So we would do a t-test to see whether or not gamma, the difference between U1 and U2 is greater than zero. If it's zero, then those two groups are stacked on top of each other. There's no difference between the treatment and the control. But if gamma is greater than zero, or less than zero, then there's a difference between those two populations. Bob?
John, just a small point, or I'm probably going to get to it, but in this random, in this HLM version, the grand mean is no longer. So you have the difference between two means. Are you, is that on purpose or just?
Well, we can define gamma, and there are different gammas, there are different fixed effects. And one is the grand mean. Gamma, there's a gamma for the grand mean. And we will do a statistical test to see if that is different from zero. A test of the grand mean against zero. But we can also define a gamma as the difference between two treatments. Which is what I'm doing here. So that would probably be the one of greater interest, is the difference between those two population groups. So it's a way we set up the model. We're going to have different fixed effects if we'll test for statistical significance. And I'm just giving an example of a constant or a fixed effect, which is defined as the difference between the control difference. And in our HLM models, we would be generating a gamma like that. When we do statistical tests of our gammas, the effect of these fixed factors in the dependent variable, our statistical tests focus on the differences among the means of treatment conditions. So, more often than not, we're looking not at the difference, say, between the treatment mean and the grand mean, but at the difference between two treatment means. And so we set up the models is to actually test those gammas directly, rather than looking at deviations in the grand mean as a fixed effect. But they're both fixed effects. The difference between the grand mean and the treatment mean is a fixed effect. And the difference between two treatment means is also a fixed effect, which is different ways of testing the same thing. The particular differences are fixed constants and they're substantive interest. So fixed factors are the things we're really interested in. And they are fixed constants. They don't change from one experiment to the next. They're always the same thing. And when we do an omnibus test, we do an analysis of variance with, say, three groups or four groups. We end up with an F ratio with lots of numerator degrees of freedom. Like, you have three groups, you have 2 degrees of freedom in the numerator. If you have four groups, you have 3 degrees of freedom in the numerator. You have multiple degrees of freedom in the numerator. That's called an omnibus F test. If you have a significant omnibus F test, you do a one-way ANOVA with like four groups, and you have 3 degrees of freedom, that's significant. You usually follow that up with post hoc comparisons to figure out which of the groups are different from each other. Those procedures have been developed because these differences among those means are of substantive interest. You want to know which groups differ from each other. Why do we get that significant omnibus test? And those particular differences are important to us. If they're important to us, then they're fixed. We need to fix the test. So as an example, we designed a study to assess the effects of barbiturates and alcohol on the number of errors made during a simulated driving test. So we get the following. This is the these are the populations. We don't know this, or we have the sample results, but suppose this is these are the actual populations. We have a placebo condition, use of one, and this is the placebo group. We have a barbiturate population and an alcohol population. And these are errors on a simulated driving test. So there are very few errors. If you're taking placebo, and if you're drinking alcohol, there are lots of errors. And that's a kind of barbiturate. Who knows what that is, but anyway, these are the populations. Okay? Those are the use. So, in this case, we could estimate two fixed effects that probably would be of interest to us. We do a post hoc test. We find that there's a significant difference in those three groups we're going to know. Now we're going to follow that up to figure out why they're different. So we would follow it up with post hoc comparisons, where we probably want to compare the placebo condition to the two alcohol conditions, or the two drug conditions, to see if drugs, these drugs generally have an effect on driving performance. And that's one comparison. So that's gamma one. It's the difference between placebo and the average of those two treatment conditions. That's one fixed effect of interest. And the other fixed effect of interest would be the difference between the two drug conditions, to see if there's a difference between alcohol and barbiturates. So there are two fixed effects that we're interested in measuring, and we want to know what those numbers are, those constants, those differences between the population groups. If we were to find that the test for gamma 2 was not significant in our postdoc test, that would be a type 2 error. Why do I say that's a type 2 error? If gamma 2 is not significant, we test that for the post-hoc test, we do a statistical test, and it's not significant, but pretty close. So getting a non-significant difference error is likely. But why do I call that a type 2 error?
The tau isn't great enough. There probably is a difference between the two.
Well, there is a difference. The difference is that. I mean, these are the population values, and there is a difference. If they weren't different, then it would be right on top of each other. And gamma 2 would be 0. But there is a difference. They've separated those distributions, so there is a difference. And so if we find that the statistical test for gamma 2 is not significant, then that's a type 2 error. Because if there's a difference, you would detect it. This is too small a difference to detect. We need one power. So those are fixed effects, and those are things that you're probably most familiar with. random effects are the things that cause us the problems in these experiments, the things we have to be aware of that are problematic. The random factors, the levels of the independent variables of the groups, represent a random sample from a large population of potential levels. So we don't have placebo and alcohol, which are just the two levels of interest. We're randomly sampling levels from a population of potential levels. So if you were to do a drug study and treat drug as a random factor, you have a whole mess of drugs, different drugs. If you just randomly select two drugs, and then that would be a random factor, would be the two you selected from that population of potential drugs. Nobody's going to do that. They're really interested in alcohol, or they're really interested in barbiturates, or methamphetamine or something, but they're not going to randomly sample levels like that and do an experiment to see if there's an effective drug on driving performance. But what we end up with are these random factors with nested factors, we're randomly sampling the levels of that independent variable as a random factor from a population of potential levels. Our inferences are drawn about the population from which we draw these levels. It's not about the particular levels that are present in our experiment. It's not like the particular levels of alcohol and barbiturates. We're just generally interested in, say, therapists, generally, they use a particular method of psychotherapy. So we're not interested in particular therapists that participate in our experiment, because they're drawn at random from a potential from a population of many different therapists that could administer that treatment. And we're not interested in particular people. We're just interested generally in the population. So the effects of random factors constitute a random variable. They're not constants. Like the difference between placebo and alcohol is a constant. This is a random variable. It's something that changes from one experiment to the next, because you have different therapists that participate in your experiments. So it varies from one experiment to the next. Examples include therapists, physicians, you have patients nested under physicians, nested in hospitals, school teachers. Those are random factors. They're random independent variables. Firms, companies, they're random. And this is just examples of groups that are randomly sampled from the same population. This is the HLMSIM software that Takashi will be showing you later today. And you'll be generating figures that look like this for your assignments this afternoon, where you generate these distributions, and they're all generated with the same population mean of zero. They're just randomly sampled groups from the potential of an infinite number of potential groups. And so in this experiment, we've got five groups have been sampled from this population of groups, and you can see that they're distributed in the service center around zero. Next random sample of five groups, it looks a bit different. The average is below where it should be, the grand mean for the entire population, but that's a parameter. That's the mean of those five populations. And then this is another sample from that same population. You can see that what you find from one experiment to the next is changing. And so we're not really interested, and we're just interested generally in the variables.